once again. Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Now, there we go. And they're right. To come up here, you've got to get a lot of stuff turned on and set up, so we'll get it here. All right. Man, I'm wound up today, I'm going to tell you. I'm shaking. You don't make me nervous. You're a family. But anytime you handle the word of the Lord, it's got to make you a little nervous. And today's the day where we're just going to worship Him. And I'm so excited to be able to share a message with you. Hallelujah. Let's pray as we get started.
Hallelujah.
Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, I just, first of all, thank you for allowing me to proclaim your word this morning. And Father God, I know you don't need me, but Father God, you choose to use me, and I thank you. Father God, I pray for every ear that will hear today. May they be opened. I pray for every eye that will see you today, Father God, that they're looking. Father God, I just pray for every heart that they be motivated. Father God, this is a day about you, not about us. And Father God, I just ask that you set me aside today. May your word come out. Father God, may you be glorified in all that we do. It's in your Son's holy and precious name we pray. Amen. Amen. Excuse me. Between Malachi, which is the last book of the Old Testament, for those who aren't extremely familiar with the Old Testament, and the events recorded in the New Testament Gospels, we've got about 400 plus years of spiritual blackness without any prophetic light. 400 years of stillness without any prophetic voice. And then suddenly and dramatically, this strange man came streaking onto the scene that was totally black. The word says he was a burning and shining light. Jesus, the greatest character in history, says there is no man comparable to him. Not Isaiah, not Moses, not Jeremiah, not any. Not any of the Tyrene saints. He's a very extraordinary individual. The spiritual giant of a man that comes striding out of the wilderness wearing different clothes, eating different foods, carrying himself in an extremely different way, and making demands on the people that made them think of Elijah, the great prophet. His voice thundered until the folks began to come and hear for themselves what he was proclaiming. The religious establishment investigated him, disliked him, feared him, rejected him, and was denounced by him. King Herod was afraid of him. John the Baptist was his name, the son of a priest who was married to the daughter of a priest. His birth had been foretold. He had been raised very strictly with the view of becoming a priest. He also had been raised as a Nazarite with the view to his becoming a prophet. John was the cousin of Jesus. Even in the womb of Elizabeth, his mother, John was filled with the Holy Spirit. The whole of John's life was given over to God's call, to serve God's specific purpose, to be the forerunner of Jesus' ministry, and for pointing others ultimately not just to repentance, but to the Christ. His preaching was changing and challenging everything, most especially the religious establishment. They were so steeped in tradition and ritual that God was pushed to the background. They had laws for this, and they had laws for that. And every portion of their lives was governed by these laws. Not that laws aren't good, but these weren't God's laws. They were additions to God's laws, and they were legalistic, and legalism kills. They needed to be set free from all of this and turn from it to the great liberator of the souls. John the Baptist is one of the most important persons in the New Testament. He's mentioned at least 89 times. 89 times. John had the special privilege of introducing Jesus to the nation of Israel. He also had the difficult task of preparing the nation to receive their Messiah. He called them to repent of their sins and to prove that repentance by being baptized and then living changed lives. There are few people in the Gospels concerning whom we have so much detail about, or whom the Lord has so much to say. Yet John's period of service probably only covered 6 months. He was a unique personality, rugged, strong, very humble. He was a child of godly parents. He was spirit-filled, and he was the Lord's forerunner. No study of Christ is complete without understanding his forerunner, the human who introduced him to the world. John the Baptist is the first soul winner we read about in the New Testament. And he was a pioneer in every sense of the word. He not only prepared the way of the Lord, but as we study him and as we apply these verses to our own lives, it will help prepare us to do the same good work, to testify concerning the Savior. His primary role is that of a witness, a testimony to the light. In today's text, we find that role fleshed out in John's witness. In these verses, John the Baptist illustrates what it means to be a proper witness of the light. First off, we're going to look at, as we continue on, we're going to look at the historical significance of this passage. What did it mean to the people in that day? Next, we want to bridge the gap from the first century to the 21st century, put into a practical application for us here today. And third, we're going to view my role as a witness. So as we start off, again, first we'll look at the scriptural and historical significance of these 15 verses. And as we do this, we're going to look at them in two chunks. Two rather large chunks, but first we'll look at verses 19 through 28. And then we'll look at verses 29 through 34. And the first thing we're going to talk about is the deflecting witness. The deflecting witness. Since we already stood to read the verses, I'm going to read the 19 through 28 again. It says, "Now this is a testimony of John, when the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, 'Who are you?' He confessed, and he did not deny, but confessed, 'I am not the Christ.' And they asked him, 'What then, are you Elijah?' And he said, 'I am not.' 'Are you a prophet?' And he answered, 'No.' Then they said to him, 'Who are you, that we may give an answer to those who sent us? What do you say about yourself?' He said, 'I am the voice of one crying in the wilderness, make straight the way of the Lord, as the prophet Isaiah said.' Now those who were sent from the Pharisees, and they were asking him, saying, 'Why then do you baptize if you are not the Christ, nor Elijah, nor the prophet?' John answered them, saying, 'I baptize with water, but there stands one among you whom you do not know. It is he who is coming after me, is preferred before me, whose sandal strap I am not worthy to loose.' These things were done in Bethabara, beyond the Jordan, where John was baptizing." A witness of Jesus deflects. A witness of Jesus deflects. And John the Baptist was that kind of witness. John's ministry was prophesied by Isaiah. And upon his birth, his father also prophesied too, echoing the words of Isaiah. John spent his time in the wilderness until he appeared publicly to Israel. John began preparing the ground for the Messiah, bringing people to a baptism of repentance, and also pointing others to Jesus the Messiah, specifically the Lamb of God, who would die for sinners. He pointed to the greater baptism of Jesus that would deliver with the Holy Spirit. The Apostle John doesn't go into too much detail in the history of John, if you notice as you read through the book of John. But the other Gospels cover it very well. And from the other Gospels, we know that John the Baptist was about 6 months older than Jesus. His father was a priest named Zacharias. His mother was a descendant of Aaron named Elizabeth. His conception was miraculous because both Zacharias and Elizabeth were old and beyond childbearing years. When the angel Gabriel told Zacharias that he and Elizabeth were going to have a baby, you recall what happens, right? Zacharias doubted. And when he doubted, God took his voice away until John was born. While John was in the womb, he recognized Jesus. Mary had just been told she had conceived of the Holy Spirit when she went off to visit her relative Elizabeth. Nobody knew that Mary was pregnant, and nobody would have suspected it since she wasn't even married yet. But the baby in Elizabeth's womb knew, and he testified in the only way a baby knows how. He jumped, and he kicked in the womb. Then after John was born, the scriptures are silent about his early years. The only thing we know is that he grew up and lived in the deserts until he began his ministry. While he was in the desert, God called him to be a witness. He had a simple message. It certainly wasn't designed to attract people. It didn't tickle the ears. It wasn't even flowery or emotional or sensitive or feel good. It wasn't creative or entertaining. All he preached was, repent. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near. He preached and he baptized as a symbol of repentance. Anytime you talk about repentance, it rubs some people the wrong way, doesn't it?
Yes, it does, preacher.
Sadly, because most people think, I've got nothing to repent of. I live a pretty good life. The people in our day who don't think they need to repent, they can be good people, right? We all agree to that. They might even be church-going people. They might even be church leaders or teachers or even preachers. In John's day, they were priests and Levites. They were good religious folks. And when John told them to repent, you know what? They didn't like it. So they asked him, who in the world do you think you are? Take a step back with me for a minute. Who was John? He was a prophet called by God. His whole life had been spent in preparation for this moment. He knew the prophecies. He knew what his role was. He knew that he was the object of biblical prophecy. How tempting it must have been to fire off a list of qualifications to those who were questioning him. How tempting must it have been to say, who am I? I'll tell you who I am. But he didn't. He didn't. Why? Because it wasn't about him. It wasn't about his qualifications. It wasn't about his background or who he was. It was about Jesus. He flatly told them, I am not the Christ. I am not Elijah. I am not the prophet that Moses talked about. So they asked him again. You know what he said? He said, I'm just a voice. I'm just a voice. All I am is the one who goes before the king to clear the brush off of the road. I'm a road clearer for the king. In other words, it's not about me. Don't look at me. Look at the one I'm pointing to. Look at the one I'm clearing the way for.
That's right.
That's what a true witness does. A witness doesn't point to their works, to their accomplishments. A witness doesn't point to their qualifications or their personalities. A true witness always deflects. Listen, you might have a phenomenal testimony, but if it doesn't deflect to Jesus, it's not truly witnessing. If a testimony leaves people thinking more about you than it does Jesus,
that's good, man. That's good.
It's not a true witness. A true witness deflects. A true witness of Jesus deflects your story to the person and to the work of Jesus. But not only does a witness deflect, a witness directs. Let's look at verses 29 through 34 real quick. The next day, John saw Jesus coming toward him, and he said, Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. And that this is he of whom I said, after me comes a man who is preferred before me. He was before me. I did not know him, but that I should be revealed to Israel. Therefore, I came baptizing with water. John bore witness, saying, I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it remained upon him. I did not know him, but he who sent me to baptize with water said to me, upon whom you see the Spirit descending and remaining on him, this is he who baptizes with the Holy Spirit. And I have seen and testified that this is the Son of God. As we said, a witness directs. When I say that a witness deflects, I'm saying just like John, we tell people that it's not about us.
That's right.
Now, on the other hand, when I say that a witness directs, we tell people who it's really about, Pastor.
That's right.
It's one thing to deflect attention from ourselves. That's easy. It's completely another direct attention to Jesus. But that's what John did. You have to understand this. That's what John did. And listen, I think the passage loses something in the way that we read it. So many times we read it like John is calmly standing in his camel hair robe. And he looks peacefully down the shoreline. And in his most distinguished voice, he says, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin. Listen, I don't think it was like that at all.
Help us, preacher.
He was the one he had waited his whole life to point out. Everything he was, everything he had prepared for his whole life was focused on this moment. So when he saw Jesus, man, I bet he shouted with joy and excitement. He said, look! It's him! Jesus is the one I've been telling you about. Man, I've known him since we were kids. But until this moment, I didn't know. But he's the one. It's him. He's the one. Look. Can you see that much better? Can you? He was excited. You got to read those verses for what they're worth. On August 8th, 2008, the Christian singer Stephen Curtis Chapman, no relation that I'm aware of, although we both grew up in Kentucky, and he and his family were on the Larry King show. Now, I don't know if you know the story, but a few months before, their youngest daughter was killed in a tragic incident, accident.
Help us, preacher.
As their 16-year-old son was pulling into the driveway, the little girl ran out with excitement. She loved her big brother. She just wanted to see him and play with him. She ran out into the driveway. He didn't see her, and he ran over. Stephen and his wife performed CPR on their baby girl as the Lord took her home. What a tragic story, isn't it? What a heartbreaking story. My goodness. Imagine what that family must be going through every single day. Imagine what the brother must be going through every day. Do you know every time they were asked about it in the interview?
Help us, preacher.
You know what they did? They directed people to Jesus.
Wow.
It was as if they were standing there with John saying, there he is. There is the one who gives me strength. There is the one who gives me peace that surpasses all understanding. I can't explain it at all. I can't understand it. But there he is. He's in it. He's in it all. That's what being a witness is about. So many times we live our lives in front of lost people. And as we live our lives in front of them, they watch us. They might know we're Christians because we got a fish symbol on our car, or I have a clever Christian t-shirt. Or we might have even invited them to church a couple times. So they watch us.
They sure do.
But what do they see when things go wrong in your life? What do they see when things go especially well in your life? What do they see when something unexpected happens? What do they see when you face a moral dilemma? Make no mistake about it. They're watching. What do they see? Listen, it's great to invite people to church. Keep doing it. It's great to give a canned gospel presentation. You know what? Keep doing it. But it's even more than that to direct people to Jesus with the way you live. The most powerful witnessing tool we have is your life. Let me say that one more time. Your most powerful witnessing tool is your life.
That's good, preacher.
When things are great, hey, tell them it's about Jesus. When things are awful, tell them it's about Jesus. Behold the Lamb of God. It's Him. It's Jesus. It's the one I've been trying to tell you about. Look. Look how He's sustaining me. Look how He's my comfort. Look at how He's my rock and my anchor and my supply. Look at Him. A true witness directs people to Jesus everywhere and every time and in all things. A true witness deflects from himself and directs to Jesus. A true witness also decreases. The Apostle John tells us in the third chapter of his gospel, he must increase and I must decrease. God sent Jesus into a sin-infested world as the only cure, the remedy, the prescription for man's problems. Remember John 6:23? It's part of our faith outline. It says, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God, the prescription of God, is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. God sent Jesus to cure mankind of his deadly disease. But because men love darkness, they love their sin, and they're blinded by pride, and they're blinded by Satan. They don't understand that their greatest need is Jesus Christ. John the Baptist's gospel wasn't some great social gospel that taught people to love and to be kind and that sort of thing. Not at all. Not at all. Because attacking behavior is always secondary to what really matters, which is the heart or the character of the person. John's message was one of genuine heart change. It was an attack that struck the hearts of his hearers. That's why in Matthew's gospel, we find the multitudes coming to John for baptism. When this group of people come to him, John said to them, what are you doing down here? You need to go home and do something with what you've learned. You need to repent and prove to God and to us that there's been real change in your life. Now, these were fine, upstanding citizens of the community. In other words, their conduct may have been convincing enough, Pastor Ricky. But their hearts were cold and wicked and far from God. Let's transition from the first century. Let's look at the 21st century, how this applies to us today. I'm deeply impressed with John the Baptist's willingness to promote the Lord Jesus Christ. He was a powerful witness to the Savior, and his willingness to proclaim the message of God gave him and his faithfulness. I'm sorry. He made a powerful impact by his proclaiming and his faithfulness to Christ on thousands of people. Let me add one more thought. Sorry. God's call to prepare people for Christ, his call to promote, his call to proclaim, his call to testify to Christ is still the same today.
Yeah, it is.
You and I have the greatest news known to man. We have the greatest remedy to the greatest disease ever known to man.
That's right, preacher.
It answers to life's most troubling questions.
That's right.
And we are compelled by all of that with the call of God to tell the world over. Who are you telling today? Who'd you tell yesterday? What made this possible in John's life, you might ask? It was his personal experience of Christ that sealed it for him. He had already been a powerful voice. But now under attack, he shows three inner qualities that must exist in our lives. Three inner qualities that must prevail so that Christ gets the glory. So that he is the one who is seen. So that they might hear, that they might know, and that they might believe. So what are they, you're asking? First of all, it's self-denial. Self-denial. This is one area that many of us struggle with. Mm-hmm. And this guy right here will raise his hand first. America's culture, along with our postmodern mindset, says, it's all about you. It's all about what you want, what you need, what you think, what you believe. Reality is, it's all about God. Remember John's answer to the religious leaders when they came and questioned him? They wanted to know who he was. They said, are you Jesus? Are you Elijah? Are you Moses? He answered no to all these questions. What they were asking was, well then, who are you? Now John could have said, I'm John the Baptist. I don't know if that was his last name then or not, but he could have said, I'm John. I'm the forerunner of Christ. I have come to prepare the people for the Lord. I am his greatest prophet. And the Messiah, he's my kin. That's my cousin. John could have answered any number of ways to draw attention to himself and to steal the glory.
That's right.
But he didn't do that at all. Notice his answer in verse 23. Again, John said, I am just a voice. Just a voice. That's it. Just a voice. Just a messenger. Just a witness. Listen, until we come to that place in our lives that all we care about is promoting Jesus, then we'll continue to steal the show from him.
That's good preaching, man.
There must be this inner quality of self-denial in our lives. Our lives are to be about Jesus. But so often, we make it about us. Someone has said, this is the struggle of the ego. And you can use those letters to say, edging out God. When your ego is too big, then you're stealing attention that belongs to Christ. When your ego is involved again, you're edging God out. When God gets edged out, you'll lift yourself up in pride every time. And you'll start to think, you deserve credit for what he accomplished in your life. The second inner quality that must be present is a servant's heart. When John said that he was just a voice, what he was saying was that he recognized that Jesus was Lord, and he was not. Oh, that's a lesson that many of us need to learn today, that Jesus is Lord, and we are not. God had called and commissioned him to do this thing, and he did it. John never changed courses. He never decided that this wasn't what he wanted to do. There's not enough in it for me. There's not enough publicity. Rather, he spent his entire life preparing for this calling. And he gave his life in pursuit of it. The issue that you need to come to grips with is who is in charge of your life. Let me say that one more time. I want everyone to hear that. Who is in charge of your life? When you make Jesus the Lord of your life, and then it follows that his interests become your interests.
That's right.
And his commands are to be followed by the best of your ability. A person with a servant's heart is a person who has the best interests of others on their mind. You see, personal recognition, personal pleasure, personal anything is never their first concern. They serve out of a genuine and out of a godly concern for others. Why do you think John subjected himself to what he did? He had a great concern for people. And he gave his life to prepare them for the coming Christ. Why did Moses serve like he did? Even praying at one point that if it were possible, that he would trade his salvation for the salvation of all the Israelites. Why did Paul suffer like he did? They had a servant's heart. But look, neither man started out that way. They both started running and stealing the show. But God came in and they both experienced the Lord in unique ways. And they were changed from the inside out. When you have a servant's heart, your greatest satisfaction will come from seeing the personal growth and betterment of the people that you are serving. So as long as your heart goes unchanged, it's all about you. On a personal side, let me tell you, the one reason I am so proud and proud in a godly sense. And I'm excited to share the pulpit with Pastor Ricky and Pastor Darren. It's because I know that no matter what I'm doing, whether I'm preaching, whether I'm teaching, whether I'm doing just some mundane church task like vacuuming the floors, they're rooting for me. They're cheering for me. They want me to succeed. And I want the same for them. I want the same. When we have success, the kingdom has success.
That's right.
The last inner quality is absolute surrender to the will and to the work of God. Absolute surrender. The Pharisees want to know why John was doing these things if he wasn't the Messiah or one of the other men. Now, this wasn't an unfair question. When John began baptizing Jews, many of them took offense to the act. The Pharisees, as you can imagine, strongly objected to it. Excuse me. You see that the Jews considered themselves God's chosen people. But then here comes this man who tells them that they're strangers to the grace of God. They were aliens, separated from God because of their sin. They needed to repent and be baptized so they would be ready for Christ's coming. The Pharisees found the message offensive. How many people do you know today that find the message of Christ offensive? How dare you come along and suggest that they need repentance or ritual cleaning in the Jordan? They were God's people, or so they thought. When they asked John why he was doing these things, he again proclaimed Christ. His authority came from God. And then he added that while they were so worried about his authority, they really needed to be concerned with the one who was coming. That John wasn't even worthy to untie his shoes. John's encounter with Christ reinforced his view that he was at the very best nothing in comparison to the Savior. He was nothing in comparison to the Savior. All he could afford to offer him, all we can afford to offer him, is absolute surrender to the will of God. And let God have His way in our lives. Let me say that one more time. All he could offer, all we can offer, is absolute surrender to the will of God. And let God have His way in our lives. Have you wholly surrendered to the Lord? Have you wholly surrendered your life to Christ? Are you still playing Christian games? Are you playing games with the grace that He so beautifully bestowed upon you? Finally, we're going to come to my role as a witness. And as we look at your role as a witness to the light, think about the qualities that we just talked about. Self-denial, a servant's heart, absolute surrender. Are you possessors of these qualities? Let me help you see. Sorry, skipped a page. We all agree that we've been called to profess Christ in this dark and dying world. Right?
Amen.
We all agree that we ought to do everything we can in the bounds of Scripture to reach people. Right?
Amen.
We all agree that we need to be winning people of all ages and of all cultural backgrounds, right?
Amen.
Whether old, middle-aged, or young, right? Mm-hmm. Would you say that reaching young families and children to the Lord Jesus Christ is something that we need to do? Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Okay. We all agree on these things. But are we possessed enough of self-denial to do it? Are we possessed enough of self-denial to reach them? I told you that we're going to have to change our worship service. Make it more contemporary. Or make it more gospel-based. And that we had to sing new songs. That we had to speed it up or slow it down. What's your initial reaction?
Help us, preacher.
But I told you that I thought we ought to do some other things that aren't traditional. But we had to change it up. How do you respond? You and I both know that answer. And the whole point is this, that we have built a religion that suits our comfort zone.
Wow.
And anything that is different or that makes us uncomfortable is unwelcome. So more often than we realize, we put our needs, we put our desires before the multitudes who are dying without knowing that we hold the remedy. You know why we do that? It's because we're too full of self. We're not full of Christ enough. We're really not interested in serving other people or being absolutely surrendered. Listen, if you saw a ministry that was in need at this church, and you were able to meet that need, would you surrender your time to meet that need? A servant's heart will compel you to forget about your personal comfort.
That's right.
So that you can meet the needs of other people. And since we're talking about people's need for Christ, both salvation and personal growth, we're talking about you that has a heart that breaks because people's spiritual needs aren't being met. It's already been said earlier today, thousands of people probably just here in Prince William County will die today, this week, this month. How many are going to hell without hearing the word of Christ? That should break every one of our hearts.
It should, preacher.
It should crush them. If nothing else motivates you to share the message of Christ, that should be enough. So how do we get these inner qualities of self-denial, a servant's heart, and absolute surrender? Let me tell you what, how. We need a fresh encounter with Christ.
A fresh,
I like that. A lady once asked the evangelist Billy Sunday. He was a famous evangelist. Why he kept having revivals when they didn't last? Rather than answering her question, he asked, "Why do you keep taking baths?"
Oh.
It doesn't matter how spiritual you were yesterday or last month.
That's good, preacher.
Or last year. Listen, it doesn't matter to me what you did for the Lord 10 years ago or 20 years ago. What I'm interested in this morning is whether you have an encounter with Jesus today. Today I want to invite you to meet with this Jesus of the Bible and recognize that He alone is Lord of your life. He is worthy of your attention and of your love. And that He above all else ought to be proclaimed in your life to others. You must be willing to submit your head and your hands and your heart to Him simply because it is His will. And that you do so because He is absolutely worthy of you doing so. Jesus' entire life was about self-denial and serving others, not being served. And about being absolutely surrendered to the will of the Father. Are these qualities you desire? You and I stand today at the front line of a great conflict between dark and light. And like John, we're called to proclaim Jesus to a dying world. To prepare the people for the Lord and His kingdom. You have the antidote for the sin problem that has swept our nation. Will you too be a voice of one crying in the wilderness? Will you position yourself today for an encounter with Jesus like you've never had before? The only one stopping you is you. As we come to this time of response, I want to ask each person here, are you sold out? Are you absolutely surrendered to the will of God? Understand this morning. God does not want your leftovers. Too many so-called Christians today are only giving God the scraps that the world does not want. Where does God fall in your life's priority list? Is He ranked above your job? Above your pleasure? Above your family? This past Christmas that fell on a Sunday, is He ranked above Santa Claus? much of your life are you giving to Christ? And how much is taken up with excuses as to why you can't?
Preacher.
If he's not number one, then where does he fall in your life? If you're not fully surrendered to Christ, you are surrendered to the world and the ruler of the world. As I was doing my quiet time this week, I've been in the book of Revelation. And while there, I kept coming across the different verses that talked about the Lamb's Book of Life. The Lamb's Book of Life, where the names of all who are saved is written. Now, I'm not going to stand up here and tell you that I have a complete understanding of God's sovereignty and man's responsibility when it comes to salvation. But the Word of God is clear. Both exist. And what I do know is that they're not enemies. They're friends. What I was blown away about as I studied God's Word, is that at the foundation of the world, God the Father, and God the Son, and God the Spirit had my name on their lips. And understand this. The hand of God wrote my name in the Lamb's Book of Life. That blows me away. My name was on the lips of the Savior. His hand wrote my name. My name. Who am I? I'm nobody. He wrote my name. Is your name written in the book this morning? The altar's going to be open in just a moment. Listen, I want two things to take place. One. If you don't know your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life this morning, I plead with you. I urge you. Come to the front and talk to Pastor Darren or Pastor Ricky, who will be standing up beside me. And they can show you in God's Word how you can know for sure. For everyone else, take this moment. Evaluate the kind of witness that you've been for Christ. Are you still trying to serve Christ and the world? Do you still have one foot in and one foot out? Know that that's where you stand today. You're not serving Him at all. That you cannot be an effective witness for Him until you're sold out for Him. Today is the day that we have a fresh encounter with God. Today is the day that I urge you, if you can't say you have the inner qualities that I mentioned, come forward, grab a knee at the altar today. Bow your head. Seek God's face. Have that fresh encounter with the Savior this morning. I urge you, beloved, get right with God this morning. Get your life turned and pointed towards Him. Dedicate your life to Him. John the Baptist gave us a great example. Christ has called you to have a fresh encounter today. And I ask you, what are you going to do? Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, I don't know the hearts of your people. But Father God, I for one am so thankful that at the foundation of the world, you wrote my name in the book. Father God, I thank you for that. Lord, I thank you for the encounter that you've allowed me to have with you just this week alone. Lord, I just pray for each and every person here. That, Father God, that pride doesn't keep them from having that encounter today with you. Father God, that today is the day they recommit their life to you. And Father God, if they don't know you, that today is the day that they experience your saving grace. Lord, I do love you. I want to be sold out to you. I want to be absolutely surrendered to you. I want to have a servant's heart for you. And Father God, I want to put myself last and always put you first. And Father God, I pray that for each person here. Lord, that as a church, we become one heart with a fresh encounter today with you. Help us, Jesus. Help us. It's in your Son's holy name that I pray.